questions from Jay Malish, if anybody has any. Ronkey.
Hello, Ronkey Phillips from Rightfully London News. I just wondered, you've summarised the number of prosecutions, all have been unsuccessful. As Martin was saying, do you think that until there is a successful prosecution, the mindset will not change?
Well,
I haven't really addressed that in your report.
I do look at that fact in the report and refer to the fact that over 15 years.
Yeah, you've given a summary, but you haven't addressed the way forward. I just wondered what.
Well, I hope I have, but as you can see, it's a very lengthy report. In the report, what I suggest is that there has to be a different way of investigating. The IPCC have lead investigators, currently, many of them, a significant percentage. Of the lead investigators are former police officers, so I have recommended that they should be phased out, and that the IPCC and it is being reformed, it is being changed at the end of this year, its structures will change. But as part of that, that they have to wean themselves off the police because they've had 10 years to do that. Then you can understand as a new organisation why you would have to have that. But for the families, the perception of the police investigating the police is not something that enhances their sense of independence in the process. But what they have to do is ensure that those who are in there are properly trained. And this isn't something Martian that suggests, it's happening in Scotland. We have procurators fiscally who are not from a police background, who investigate, who attend the scenes of death and direct the police indeed in their forensic investigation. So there are other models for them to follow. And what I suggest for the IPCC to improve what they're doing is that they remove themselves from a situation where you have a commissioner and you have a lead investigator. The lead investigator goes off and does their stuff and then comes at the end of it. To have the occasional meeting and then produce a report to the commissioner, but that there should be a new model for investigation of these cases in the IPCC, which should be that there should be a death and serious incident unit, a specialist, high expertise unit, which is capable of and experience in these matters. Now, given that they straddle the whole of England and Wales, obviously, you can't have one unit geographically which is going to do that. What you do is you have that as a source of absolute expertise. You have then people who are experienced and confident about the scenes of deaths, who can go out there from a local IPCC in order to liaise with the police, whilst communicating with the experts and units who are making their way there. And that these units take over the investigation of these cases, as you have in many other respects in the CPS. You have sexual offences units, you have domestic violence units, and you have deaths units in the CPS now. Again, the recognition that these are extraordinarily complex and difficult cases, they require the greatest expertise in those who are investigators. But that doesn't mean to say you have to have knowledge about how police work and their operations, but that doesn't have to mean you have to have been a police officer for many years in order to do that. So that is a very significant way, and that those should be done in a team basis. So it's not just one person. One of the examples given by families was that you have one person doing this. If they have the flu, if they go off maternity leave, or if anything happens, they move, they get promotion, the whole thing stutters along, and we go back to the beginning, have someone else come in, and the family got to get to know someone else, and the prosecution or the investigation goes along slowly, and then someone else has to come in and brief themselves. What you have is a team-based approach. If you look at homicide investigations, it's not one person investigating a homicide. The whole resources of the state go into these cases. They're deluxe in the way in which they're funded compared to other types of crime. There is no reason why the state should not be doing that for these deaths. There are not that many of them. We're not talking about hundreds of these deaths in these circumstances in police cells, but there are sufficient numbers for us still to be very concerned and to ensure we get the best investigative approaches to these. And that requires another change in processes, which is the CPS, the IPCC, the Health and Safety Executive, if Health and Safety is involved, get together at a very early stage, within 14 days I recommend, together to look at what's emerging here. Now, the reason cited against that is, well, we can't. We have these Chinese walls of independence. Independence is not about isolation. If you're isolated, you're not independent, because you can't. You need to communicate effectively and ensure that emerging evidence is considered in order that they can look at, advise and help each other in the approach to that. And that's really important. It's complete nonsense what's been going on for many years, this compartmentalised approach to all, sequential approach to all. Needs to be moving forward at pace. I suggest consideration of time limit for these investigations. And
that's a willingness to prosecute.
And clearly, that's a matter of a desire to prosecute. There have been no successive prosecutions in any of these cases over the last 15 years, nor any convictions for manslaughter in any of these cases. There is no surprise at family. and effort, and it requires a radical change of approach and an openness on the part of these agencies not to be defensive. Because this isn't about blaming police in the future. This is about preventing some young police officer full of good intentions and a great career ahead of him, not finding himself suspended, alienated from his family and his colleagues thereafter, and facing the prospect of a discipline and a worse homicide charge because he's not trained properly, or perhaps he's not equipped because he doesn't have the skills. Police officers are not just required to run quickly down Oxford Street. They're required to empathise, communicate, listen, and be able to identify mental health and where people are severely intoxicated. That's a complex set of skills we're now asking for police officers in the 21st century, and that has to be recognised in the training and indeed in the level of recruitment of police officers in the future as well.
Simon Isher, Channel 4 News. What do you think about the government response in terms of the amount of time the families on the platform and many other families that we've met have had to wait for the case to be concluded? 4 years, 5 years, 9 years in one case, at least one case. How do your recommendations, or how should the government respond to your recommendations to speed up that process?
Well, the government has responded on a thematic basis, looking at the general areas, and there are some very positive developments in there. However, the idea of referring this to the ministerial board and council, which consists of the three ministers, the Justice Minister, the Home Office Minister, and Health Minister, who can rotate, of a council of perhaps over 20 people from different agencies. Of course, they may be experts in their area, but some people sometimes can't make a meeting, quick apologies, or change again. So you have this slightly amorphous group taking forward these recommendations. What is it? That's why I recommended a mechanism for enforcement of this, a mechanism where someone can really take this forward and ensure that it's happening. And I think that's going to be the difficulty and the challenge for the government, is ensuring that this just doesn't get kicked into the long grass. Because there's some very fine reports, I refer to them in my report, with the fabulous recommendations, which had they been implemented, we would not see some of the deaths occurring over the last few years. And as I think that's very important, is that
so you can't see anything at the moment.
Well,
that
I can
speed up from the response.
I think the council is to be reformed in its mechanism. I think there's to be a greater resource given to it for a secretariat that can take it forward. It may well be that they can deliver this very quickly, therefore you can't prejudge what they can do under the reform. But what has gone before doesn't suggest that is necessarily the best vehicle for doing it. And the important thing is this must happen. It's got to happen, it's got to happen, it's got to be done. For the very same reasons why I've looked at the not just simply at high level issues for these organisations, I have drilled down into the everyday as to what's effect has. And you need to have a mechanism for taking this forward that is lean and mean and able to go on with it, not something which is going to be another debating forum. There's been a lot of talk and very good conversations and very sincere people wanting to do something. Now's the time to actually do it. There's been 9 months from the time of my report being submitted. Now we need to see this happen very quickly. Even the legal aid regulations, they need to be changed, but there are families who will, sadly, over the course of the next 6 months, are going to lose a loved one, given what's gone before in these circumstances. There needs to be emergency regulations to amend it, not something simply put into the normal parliamentary timetable. That's really important. And also we need to look at retrospectively about what's happened to all these families. Some families, the cost of representation through this can be something like £60,000 to £70,000. People might have a house that's worth that, but they have to remortgage their house in order to attend and meaningfully participate in a process which has resulted in the death of our loved one. It does not mean that has to be changed.
Danny Shaw from BBC, forgive me if someone's already asked this, but I had to come out. One of the recommendations is to stop former police officers at the IPCC from leading investigations into custody deaths. They will probably counter, and the police will probably counter, is that the people who are most experienced and have the most specialist skills in investigating these really complex cases happen to be former police officers, former detectives. So where are you going to find these great specialists to do those inquiries if they're not drawn from the ranks of the police?
Well, I hate to suggest that you're parochial in England about this, but you only have to look north of the border. I don't want to cite Scotland too much, but you have the procurator. You have people who have come from a legal background. You also have recognition officers there who carry out inquiries into those who come from a variety of backgrounds, including banking, or who are paralegals, who very, very quickly are trained because they go out with the police. They attend seminars in the issues which the police are training in, and they can pick up that over a number of years. And that's why I see this at IPCC. It's not a question of excluding police influence in the IPCC. Clearly, there may be a role for the police in training and in mentoring people from the stage. And I'm not suggesting that we make all of these officers redundant. What they must do is phase them out. They need to stand on their own legs, and they need to develop their own expertise. They don't have to necessarily do that here. They can go to Northern Ireland, where the Ombudsman there in his office. They can also go to the Property Fiscals or the police in Scotland, so that they can learn and train and spend time with those at that stage. The problem with the IPCC, and I'm not criticising them, is they have not hitherto had the resources to be able to investigate these cases in that way, or to have the training that is necessary, or to recruit at sufficiently senior level, because it's very, very expensive to live somewhere in London. The police have that difficulty too. But what they have to do is ensure that they become an organisation that is self-sufficient and can look out with the organisation for expertise and bring in